A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining us today on a webinar on Supreme Court ruling on software payments and way forward. As we know that this is a very recent judgment that is passed by the Supreme Court, and today's webinar, our speaker, CA Amit Patni, will cover topics like impact on software payments in the context of international payment, changes in the withholding tax and treaty impact, understanding copyright and copyrighted articles in new perspective and retrospective tax, benefits and tax planning. May I request Dr. Renu Shom, Director of EU Chambers, who has been associated with the Chamber for more than a decade now, and is responsible for the overall activities of the Chamber, to kindly formally welcome everyone.
Thank you, Anvita. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, let me extend a very warm welcome to all of you present for this webinar on the Supreme Court ruling on software payment way forward, and also Mr. Amit Patni, who is the Associate Director, Deb Mantra Financial Services Private Limited. For the benefits of the audience, I would just like to briefly talk about what Mr. Amit is. CA Amit is a member, in fact, of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. With more than 15 years of a professional experience, he was the tax director at PwC. As an associate director at Deb Mantra, he has innovated the process of due diligence and the instrumental in making this completely virtual. Amit is an incisive and analytical individual with extensive knowledge in the field of Indian corporate tax, international tax, transfer pricing, corporate restructuring and GST, and so on. He has a rich and extensive experience in the local tax planning, inbound investment and entry strategies, treaty issues, merger and acquisitions, and litigation management. Sir, may I request you to kindly educate us on the subject, and we eagerly look forward to hear from you. Very, very briefly, I would just like to mention a very few activities of the Chamber. We have been set up in 1992 with the objective to promote the business between EU and India. And we are based in Mumbai, and we have been organizing a lot of webinars on the topics of interest between EU and India. Recently, we have organized many webinars on the sector specific. And so this is one of them. I would request all of you to kindly take the advantage of attending these webinars and all. We, even the Chamber has a sector committees, 7 sector committees are there, which are again very active committees. So we have been organizing a lot of activities under each committees. So we request you to kindly participate in good number and take the advantage of the speaker's knowledge and all. So with these words, I would request all of you to kindly, you know, enjoy the session. And if you have any question answers, you can definitely ask our expert. So thank you. Now over to you, Mr. Patni. Thank you.
Thank you, Renu, for introducing me. And again, very warm welcome to all of you, friends. Good evening to all. And Renu, thank you for inviting us for this topic, which is a very important and relevant topic in today's world. I'm sure many of our, you know, people in this group must have read about this judgment, must have heard about this judgment. And this is a session which we would like to cover how, and, you know, deep analysis about this judgment and how we can take benefit of this judgment going forward. So this is broadly what we are going to cover in this session. So friends, once again, good evening. And my name is Amit Patni. And today we would be covering a very important topic, that is whether the payment for the, you know, usage of computer software, whether that constitute a royalty payment. And if it is a royalty, what would be the tax implications? And we would also cover if it is not a royalty, then what would be the tax consequences of this? So friends, at the outset, let me tell you that this judgment is one of the finest judgment which I have seen in the last few years. A very well drafted judgment And if someone has read this judgment, I'm sure he must have enjoyed the beautiful interplay between the Income Tax Act and the Copyright Act, which has been brought in this judgment. So this is, I would urge all of you to have a look into this judgment. It is very well drafted judgment, and it covers a lot of areas where there were gray areas where people were waiting for the Supreme Court to take a final view on that. And the Supreme Court has given its verdict on various issues, and which we will be covering in this session. So friends, how I would like to cover this session would be like, first half would be, we will be covering about the topic, what is the judgment all about, and what are the, you know, things which we need to take care going forward. So this will be the first part of my session. And the second part, I will encourage all of you to take part in the, you know, if you have any questions relating to your royalty issues, if you want to share your experience, I would strongly encourage all of you to share that, because as we more collaborate and discuss about the topic, we all will be enriching from that. So that's what my small, humble request would be to all the participants. Make this session a little more interactive. I'm sure this is a very complex matter, and all of you must have, you know, must have experienced the complications in your daily working life. So I would encourage if you can share your experience also with us. So friends, a very simple thing to start with, just a background, that whenever we make any payment to the third party, there is an obligation for withholding taxes. And equally, when we make the payment to the foreign parties, the law of withholding tax also comes into picture. Now what the law in respect to the withholding, that when we make the payment to the foreign parties, the first and important thing which we need to understand is whether that payment is subject to tax in India or not. If the payment is subject to tax in India, the obligations of withholding gets triggered. And if the payment is not subject to tax in India, then there is no requirement for the withholding taxes in India. This has been settled by the Supreme Court in many earlier judgments. And even in this judgment, the Supreme Court has reaffirmed this principle that whenever there is a foreign payment, the first and foremost thing which we need to understand is whether that payment is subject to tax in India or not. If the payment is not subject to tax, the obligation to withhold taxes does not arise at all. Now, when we check whether the payment is subject to tax in India or not, there are two aspects which we need to consider. First is the tax treatment under the treaty, and the second is tax treatment under the Income Tax Act or the Domestic Act. Now, when we examine the tax treaty, there are different articles and provisions dealing with each of the, you know, payments. And similarly, under the Income Tax Act or the Domestic Act, we have various provisions under which we need to test whether the payment is subject to tax in India or not. Now, mind you that if a payment is subject to tax under the Act, but the same payment does not become taxable by virtue of the tax treaty, then once the tax treaty comes into picture, the ultimate outcome would be that the payment would not be subject to tax in India. Meaning that whenever there is a tax treaty, the provisions of tax treaty, which is more beneficial, can be adopted. So this is a basic principle which has been settled by the Supreme Court. And I'm sure that all of our participants are aware of this basic concept when we deal with the foreign payment. And we need to understand this in terms of the present scenario also, because whenever we make the foreign payment for the usage of computer software, we need to again apply the same principle. That is, first we need to examine whether the payment is taxable under the Domestic Act. And if it is taxable, then we need to see if the what is the position under the treaty. And if the treaty also imposes taxes in India, then only the ultimately the payment would be subject to tax in India. If by virtue of the treaty, the payment is not subject to tax in India, which is more beneficial, then there is no requirement for the withholding tax. So if you can just move the slide, please. Yeah. So this is what basically I would be covering in this session, basic concept about the royalty or and the software, and what is the Supreme Court judgment on this subject. We will cover this. And the third point would be the areas, gray areas, which are still there and what we need to be aware of going forward. So these are the three things which I will be covering from my side. And as I said, after that, we will be open for the question answer sessions and we will be happy to discuss that. Change the slide, please. So now, first, as I said, basic provision is that under the treaty, we need to understand what is the provision, and under the act, we need to understand what is the provision. Because ultimately we have to ensure that the payment is subject to tax under both scenario, that is under the treaty and under the Income Tax Act. What I have captured in this presentation is in respect to the computer software or the license payment for the usage of computer software, what are the relevant provisions under the treaty and what are the relevant provisions under the Income Tax Act. Now, friends, if you see under the tax treaty, the words of royalty has been defined. The term royalty as used in this article means payment of any kind received as a consideration for the use of or the right to use any copyright of literary, artistic, or scientific work. Now, we need to understand that whenever we make the payment for the computer software or the usage of computer software, whether the payment would fall under this definition of royalty. That is, whether this is the payment for the use of or the right to use any copyright of literary, artistic, or scientific work. This is first test which we need to apply. Likewise, under the Income Tax Act, in terms for the royalty, and the software, the relevant clauses are, as you can see in the screen, the Income Tax Act, the royalty has also been defined. Again, the royalty has been defined to include transfer of all or any rights, including the grant of the license in respect of any copyright, literary, artistic work. This is the basic provision. And under the Income Tax Act, there is another explanation, if you see explanation 4, which has been introduced, which reads as, for the removal of doubt, it is hereby clarified that the transfer of all or any rights in respect of any right, property, or information includes and have always included transfer of all or any rights for the use or right to use a computer software, including granting of license, irrespective of the medium through which such right is transferred. Friends, let me highlight that this explanation 4 was introduced by Finance Act 2012. This explanation was introduced because the government wanted to overcome certain judicial precedent which were in the favor of the SEC. To overrule those judgment, explanation 4 was introduced via Finance Act 2012. However, it was introduced with the retrospective effect from 1st April 1976. Yes, friend, this amendment or the explanation was introduced with retrospective effect. And this explanation 4 is one of the area of dispute which we will be discussing going forward. Next slide, please. As I said, this explanation was introduced with retrospective effect from 1st June 1976. And this judgment was, this explanation was introduced to overcome certain judicial precedents which were there at that point of time. Now, we will be covering in this how the Supreme Court has interpreted this explanation and what has been the position laid down by the Supreme Court in respect to this explanation 4 also. Next slide, please. So, the whole idea or the whole concept in respect to the royalty is that if the payment for the usage of computer software or the license payment, if it is a royalty, then the royalty tax would be of 10% would be applicable under the domestic law. And if the recipient has a permanent establishment in India, then the royalty would be taxed at 40%, but on the net income, not on the gross income. So, friends, this is the basic provisions which is fundamental for us to discuss further about the Supreme Court judgment and how these positions are going to be, taken care by the Supreme Court and how this will be viewed going forward. So, the whole purpose of this discussion so far is just to bring on surface the basic provisions and the how the Income Tax Act and the treaty interplays with each other when we make the payment, particularly to the non-residents. Next slide, please. Now, as I said, the words which you have must have noticed under the treaty and even under the act, they have used the word copyright. So very important for us is to understand what is copyright and how it has been defined in the Copyright Act 1957. So friends, I have just highlighted a couple of important provisions of the Copyright Act, which has been used extensively by the Supreme Court when they have decided this matter. So just for the sake of, to ensure that we cover all the points, I have highlighted this important provisions of the Copyright Act also. So Copyright Act, if you see section 14 of the Copyright Act explains that when the owner of the copyright, what are the rights of that person who is holding the copyright on the subject, what are the powers of that person has been defined in the section 14. Friends, the Copyright Act also includes the software payment, softwares. So for software also, the same Copyright Act 1957 will be applicable as it is applicable for the other cases. So section 14 is very important for us which highlights or which explains what are the powers of a person who is the owner of the copyright. Next slide, please. Now, section 16, friends, this clearly explains that in India, the copyright, all the issues relating to copyright is incorporated in the Copyright Act 1957. So meaning that for all the copyright related matters, we need to see the Copyright Act 1957. And there is another provisions, that is section 30, which enables the copyright holder to grant certain license to the third party. So section 14 is the powers of the person who is holding the copyright, and section 30 is the section where the holder of the copyright may grant license to third person in respect of the powers which were envisaged in section 14. So this is fundamental of Copyright Act, which we will be using when we will be discussing more in detail about the Supreme Court judgment. So yeah, next slide please. So friends, before we discuss about the Supreme Court judgment, I just wanted to check, so far, is there anything which we want to discuss or the issues is not clear? Because whatever we have discussed so far is very fundamental to understand the Supreme Court judgment. So if any of you have any doubt, please let me know so that we can discuss this and then we can take the Supreme Court judgment. Any issues or any point which anyone want to share?
So as of now, there's nothing in the Q&A box. Yeah.
Okay. So coming to the Supreme Court judgment, as I said, the Supreme Court, the issue before the Supreme Court was that whenever there is a payment by the resident Indian end users means the person who's actually using the software or the distributor, the second category of distributor. Distributor means those who are getting the computer software from the third party or from the non-resident, and distributors have the right to sell the software to the Indian end users. So first category is Indian end users who are like basically buying the software or the license directly from the non-resident. And the second category is the distributors who have the right from the non-resident. And the right is limited to sell the product to the Indian users in India. So these are the two categories which the Supreme Court has discussed in its verdict. Now, if I explain the facts which were there before the Supreme Court, the facts were the distributor was granted a non-exclusive, non-transferable license to resell the computer software in India. Apart from this license to resell, there was no other rights which were granted to the sub-licensee, nor there was right to re-engineer, modify, reproduce in any manner whatsoever about the software which they have got from the non-resident. Now, in consideration, the distributor was supposed to pay a fee or a license fee to the non-resident. Apart from that, very important, apart from that, the distributors does not get the right. In fact, distributor was not getting the right to use the product at all, meaning that the distributor themselves cannot use the product without the permission of the copyright holder. Now, these were the terms and conditions which were inbuilt in the agreement pursuant to which the license were got by the distributors, which were sold to the Indian consumers, and in return the distributors were paying their after deducting their income or their portion of the profit, the balance were repatriated back to the foreign copyright holder. This were the position what was discussed by the Supreme Court in its verdict. As I said, very important thing which I would like to highlight, that all the license which were there under the agreements, it was not a license in terms of Section 30 of Indian Copyright Act 1957. As I said, the license which were given to the distributors or to the end users, the license was just to use it or to resell it. Apart from that, there were no other powers, rights which were given to the distributor or end users. The rights were restricted only to use it for their own purpose. So a very important thing which we need to understand is that the power which the parties got in India were restricted or limited to the actual usage of the software, and none of the power was related to as envisaged in Section 14 or Section 30 of the Copyright Act. Section 14, as I said, explain what are the powers to commercially exploit, copy the product, resell it. Those powers were not given pursuant to what has been entered by the Indian parties. In the present context, the powers were restricted only to the end actual usage. Next slide, please. Now, what the Supreme Court has held. Now, in terms of applicability of withholding taxes under Section 195, the Supreme Court has reaffirmed the principle that the domestic provisions or treaty, we need to test both, and if the treaty provisions are more beneficial to the SEC, then those provisions will be read into the Income Tax Act, and if the payment is not subject to the treaty, pursuant to the treaty, then the payment will not be subject to tax in India. And if the payment is not subject to tax in India, then the question or the compliance under Section 195 does not trigger at all. The revenue has argued, last year there is one judgment of Supreme Court in Pilcon, where in the context of some other provisions of the Income Tax Act, that is 194E, the revenue relied on that Supreme Court judgment and said that whenever there is a payment outside India, we need to withhold the taxes irrespective whether the taxes are subject to tax in India or not. Now, Supreme Court has clarified that its own judgment of Pilcon was based on some other provisions, that is 194E, and that principle cannot be incorporated when we read the Section 195. 195 will be applicable only when the income is subject to tax in India. Whereas for the purpose of 194E, the legislator has incorporated that the withholding has to be done at a particular rate, irrespective whether the income is taxable in India or not. So that was a very fundamental difference of why the Supreme Court gave its verdict in the Pilcon judgment, and that verdict will not be applicable in the present circumstances because of the difference of the language which were used in Section 195 versus 194E. Supreme Court has also rejected that this payment for the license, even though in the agreement it is, in some of the agreement it may have been written that it is not a sale, but Supreme Court has held that we need to understand the real nature of the transactions, what we call it, substance over form. And even though the agreement
talks about the license and not the sale, but in ground or in reality, it is actually, or it has to be treated like a sale transaction. Next slide, please. Now, what has, under the treaty, what Supreme Court has said that in most of the treaties, like, you know, advanced countries treaties like Singapore, UK, USA, considering the treaty position and the OECD commentary, the Supreme Court has said that the payment which were made by the Indian taxpayers does not fall under the definition of copyright, you know, and because of that, once the payment is not or cannot be considered as a payment for the use or right to use copyright, the payment will not be considered as a royalty for the tax treaty. I'm just repeating myself that considering the rights which the Indian party got pursuant to this agreement was limited to the actual usage or to resale the product in India. And those powers cannot be equated with the powers which were envisaged in Section 14 or Section 30 of the Copyright Act. And because of this reason, those payments is not a payment for the use or right to use the copyright, and consequently the payment will not be considered as a royalty payment. So friends, the interplay between the Copyright Act and the Income Tax Act is very important. Whenever there will be any payment for the usage of computer software, we need to understand what are the powers which the recipient is getting. And if those powers cannot be considered as rights which were envisaged in Section 14 or Section 30 of the Copyright Act, if those powers were not been transferred, then that payment will not be classified as a royalty under the tax treaty provisions. Now, Supreme Court has have given a very important example to explain the position. What Supreme Court has said, and they have, it's there in the judgment copy also, that consider a case that suppose I have written a book, and because of the Copyright Act, I have a power to decide how I want to use this books. Now, say for example, that book I have published and someone has bought the book in the open market. Now, the person who is buying the book is just buying a copyrighted article. He is not buying any copyright or any power which is envisaged in Section 14 or 30 of the Copyright Act. I have not given any power to the end user who is buying a book for his own purpose or consumption. He has power just to read the book and take note of that. But certainly there is no transfer of power, like he can reproduce the book, he can, you know, copy it, he can sell it. Those powers were not transferred. The power what has been transferred is just buying a copyrighted article. And if that is the transaction, then there is no transfer of copyright from the copyright holder to the end user. The end user is effectively getting the copyrighted article. He is in fact purchasing the copyrighted article, and so it will not be considered as a royalty or the copyright payment. So with this example, the Supreme Court has clarified that the buyer is just buying a copyrighted article and consequently, this is not a copyright payment under that tax treaty. Next slide, please. Now, under the domestic law. So, when domestic law, we need to understand, friends, what is the position prior to 2012, when the explanation was not, you know, there in the statute book, and what is the impact of bringing this explanation for to the domestic law. We need to also focus on that aspect. Now, under the domestic law also, the definition of royalty as contained in explanation 2.5 of the Income Tax Act 916 of the Act, it includes the transfer of all or any rights, including the granting of a license in respect of any copyright, literary, artistic, or scientific work. Friends, if I just take a pause here, you will appreciate that this language which is used in the copyright, which is used in the Income Tax Act, is very much similar to what provisions or what are the wordings which are used in the tax treaty. I'm just repeating, the definition under the domestic law includes the transfer of all or any rights, including the granting of a license in respect of any copyright, literary, artistic, or scientific work. Now, what Supreme Court has said, that whenever we will be reading this provisions under the Income Tax Act, it gives the same flavor that in order to be classified as a copyright, we need to again refer to the Copyright Act and see whether the powers which are envisaged in Section 14 or Section 30, whether those powers were transferred to the end user or to the buyer, or the buyer is just buying a copyrighted articles. So virtually, we need what Supreme Court has said, that the wordings of the Income Tax Act and wordings of the tax treaties are similar to some extent, though the tax, the domestic law, the definition is little wider, because it contains the words like transfer of all or any rights, including the granting of the license, which were not there. But the last part, that is in respect of copyright, which is very important and very fundamental, that in order to understand the copyright, we need to again refer the Copyright Act, and we need to understand what are the powers which were transferred from the between the parties. So this is the position under the, you know, charging section of under the Income Tax Act. After this, as I said, in Finance Act 2012, there is an explanation which were introduced, and it was introduced with the retrospective effect. Now, the revenue argued very strongly that because of this retrospective amendment, there is no need to make this sort of distinction that there is a copyright article or the copyright as envisaged in the Copyright Act. Supreme Court has rejected this position, and they have clarified that this amendment is expanding the scope of the royalty, and pursuant to which this cannot be considered to be clarificatory in nature, and it has to be read with prospective date. It cannot be incorporated with effect from first of with the year 1976, but it will be read with effect from 2012, because the provisions or the scope of the royalty has been enhanced, expanded by virtue of this explanation 4. Now, Supreme Court has also clarified very important thing that even under this explanation 4, since this explanation 4 was introduced in 2012 and all the matters which were before the Supreme Court were prior to 2012, Supreme Court has clarified that these provisions cannot be considered or cannot be read when we will be considering the position prior to 2012. The simple reason is that as this explanation 4 is expanding the scope of royalty, and no one is expected prior to 2012 that the government will introduce this type of explanation. In other words, from the deductor perspective, prior to 2012, the government cannot impose adverse consequences to the deductor based on the explanation 4, which were introduced in 2012. In other words, Supreme Court has said that it is just an impossible act, meaning that prior to 2012, it was not possible for the deductor to envisage that the government is going to bring this type of amendment. So prior to 2012, there is an immunity to the deductor from the harsh consequences which will arise because of the non-deduction of taxes based on this explanation 4. And friends, let me share one important thing here, that on this matter, on this concept of impossible act, Supreme Court has referred to some of its own judgment and one judgment of the Bombay High Court in the case of Western Coalfield. Now, this is little personal for me that, you know, Western Coalfield 7-8 years back, they were like having this type of, you know, problem that because of some retrospective amendment, there were some demands on the client, and Western Coalfield came to us and I was dealing with the matter, and the assignment was how, on what grounds we should agitate the orders of the assessing officer before the first level appellate authority. And at that point of time, you know, we envisaged that this position or proposition of impossible act, and like we were first, maybe when we, you know, we added this type of, you know, grounds before the first appellate authority, that any retrospective amendment from the deductor point of view should not be applied because it is just not possible for a deductor to envisage what government is going to bring in the at a future point of time. We need to understand from the deduction point of view what is the actual statute, what is the provisions which are factually and actually present in the statute on the date when the withholding tax compliances gets triggered. Any position altered after the date of deduction cannot be used against the deductors. So I was maybe few of those who, you know, incorporated this, you know, principle in our appeals memo, and we got relief at a higher authorities, and later on the High Court has also affirmed this position of the law, and today little like, you know, feeling little more happy when the Supreme Court has taken note of this judgment or the principle of this judgment and affirmed this principle in this judgment too. Next slide, please. Now, there were discussion in the judgment or by the revenue that OECD commentary should not be used in order to interpret the treaty positions, because the government has already raised its reservation against the commentary on some of the areas or aspects. So we cannot simply rely on the OECD commentary. We need to also focus on the reservations raised by the government. Now, that proposition has also been rejected by the Supreme Court in its verdict. Now, Supreme Court has also taken note that there is a Civility Circular number 10, where the CVT itself has treated, or there is a form where there is a distinction were made by the CVT towards payment of royalty and towards payment of computer software. So the circular itself has given a flavor that those computer software and royalties can be of different nature, characteristics, and Supreme Court has also judicially taken note of this circular in its verdict. Next slide, please. Now, post-2012, a very important area which has been we need to understand, and again, someone has to take a practical decision that post-2012, whether the software payment would be royalty under the Income Tax Act. Under the treaty, it is settled now that it is not a royalty. But under the Income Tax Act, by virtue of explanation 4, whether this payment will be treated as the royalty payment or it will be treated as a business profit, because of the simple reason that this Supreme Court judgment was rendered for the years prior to 2012. And in today's scenario, whether we can still use the judgment and take a position that since there is no copyright or the powers under the Copyright Act were transferred, and so it is not a royalty. And once it is not a royalty, then explanation 4 cannot make this as a royalty by virtue of that explanation. So this is an area where I'm sure that we will be, you know, another round of litigations or judgment may come in future. This is an area which is like, there are still two views on this. Personally, I think that this judgment still holds good in the present context, but we need to wait for more clarity to come. So friends, now this judgment of the Supreme Court has come, but this is a very important judgment, very high stake are involved in this. So there is a lot of apprehension in the minds of a consultant like us, that what government is going to do in the, you know, when they will be, you know, when this budget will receive the assent of the president, will they make any further amendment to overrule this judgment? This is something which we are like, we need to wait how the government is going to respond to this judgment and what they would, what actions or steps they would take in order to redo the situation or to bring the situation in favor of the revenue. This is something which we need to wait how the government is going to respond to this judgment. This is something very important. The other important area is that whether this, once this is not a royalty payment, whether this payment would be treated as an equalization levy. Friends, last year, the scope of equalization levy has been expanded to include online sale or online service service. Now, once it is not a royalty, the another issue which emerged is whether this payment can be considered to be an item on which equalization levy will be invoked. So these are the two important things which we need to be thinking about it, how this equalization levy will be, you know, incorporated, how this equalization levy will be imposed by the government on this software payments. And another third important thing which, you know, we are working with many of our clients that, okay, this judgment has come in our favor, in favor of the taxpayer. Whatever the government will do, it will assume they will do it with a prospective date. But what will happen to those taxpayers who have already done the withholding on based on the conservative approach? Or many of you, if you are from Karnataka, there were adverse judgment of the Karnataka High Court in this matter, which has now been overruled. Now, can the taxpayer take advantage of this judgment and can claim refund of the taxes which were, you know, borne by the Indian parties when they were making the remittance to the foreign parties? Can we take advantage, can we explore the possibility to claim refund of those taxes, particularly when the Indian parties were bearing the Indian taxes and the foreign remittances were made and the taxes were paid to the government? And now with the Supreme Court clarifying that this is not a royalty payment, can the Indian end user or the Indian companies who have borne these taxes, what actions can be taken to claim refunds of those amounts which were deposited with the understanding that these payments were royalty payments, which now has been overruled by the Supreme Court? So these are the three important things which, you know, all of us needs to be aware of. I just repeat myself, what government is going to do to overrule this judgment. This is important for us to explore. Second is the impact or the levy of equalization levy on this royalty payments. And the third is, what about the taxes which were already been deposited to the government exchequer in the past based on the understanding that this is a royalty payment and those taxes were borne by the Indian companies or the customers? So these are the three important areas which we need to which we all need to work upon and to take a practical judgment how to deal with these three important areas going forward. So friends, from the, you know, from my perspective, I have given a brief overview about the judgment, what Supreme Court has held, little bit about the Copyright Act and some flavor of the treaty and how it works. So we can now open the session for the question answers and we can discuss further on this.
Thank you so much, C.A. Amit. It was really a very enlightening session, sir, here. As of now, sir, I cannot see any questions in the Q&A box.
Okay.
So I believe there are no more questions coming up. Yeah, so we can, yeah, there is one, 1 second. There's one. Miss Kanchan Ratnakar is asking, she's writing a statement saying that, so does the respective data.
Sorry?
She's writing, saying that, so does the respective data. So I...
No, not data. She's writing about the tax treaty.
Tax, yeah, okay.
So, can you please elaborate your question? I'm not able to understand what you are actually trying to, you know, refer.
She has mentioned.
Yeah, she's, I guess this is not a question. This is just a statement that she has given, maybe. So, yeah. So, as of now, I don't see any questions coming up. So, I believe we can close the session then now.
Thank you, Mr. Amit. Thank you, Mr. Amit, for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
I wanted to check with you, is it okay we can share the presentation with the participants, because this is generally the request we receive from them. So if it is okay with you, we would be happy to share, otherwise whatever you advise us.
If you just don't mind, let me just internally discuss and I will get back to you on this.
Not a problem. Okay. Thank you very much to you as well as to Mr. Vikas Tatya for, you know, having this organized with us. And also, I would like to thank each and every participant to be the part of this.